ChristYinz. Hey, what's up? It's a Christian's podcast. Glenny B in the studio. And yeah, you don't look like Jared, bro. You don't look like Jared. So, hey, Jared's on vacation with his son, and he gave us some insight to one of his young boys that he was trying to help out and be in his life. So this is Maurice. Maurice, what's good, bro?
What's good? What's going on? Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Hey, so just right off the rip, tell us a little bit about yourself. Hey, where are you from? What are you doing? School, sports, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So my name is Maurice Sims. I'm raised in Beaver County, grew up in Center Township. I got a nice family of five. I got an older brother, a younger brother, mom and dad. Grew up playing sports my whole life, playing football my whole life.
Right on.
So that's like my passion. I just got done playing football from 5 years old to 22 years old. And now I coach football.
Okay.
And now I'm going to Bible school at RTBI, Revival Today Bible Institute.
Oh, so, right on. Yeah. Shout out. Yep. That's awesome.
That's what I do now. I'm just trying to pursue my life with the Lord, trying to figure out what he wants me to do in life, and I'm just stepping in every single door that he opens for me.
Yeah, see, and that's what I like to see, man. Yeah. You got young kids, sports your whole life, you know, in the gym, look like you're in great shape, man.
Appreciate
you know what
that.
I mean? And Jesus is cool.
Yeah.
And trying to go to Bible school, trying to learn more and press in about God and everything. Mm-hmm. And that's what people need to see and people need to know, brother.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
So Bible school, like what makes you want to go to Bible school? I mean, like I said, I understand because I've talked to a lot of people like in the Bible school where I go to church and everything. Yeah. So like in your opinion, when you wrap up like, you know, God and Jesus and put it all into it and some of your life situations, brother.
Yeah. So
Bible school.
So basically the way it started, like the thought that came was like I was in church all the time. I kept going to church. And once I kept going to church and I kept hearing Pastor Jonathan, which is the pastor at Revival Today Church, once I kept hearing him preach and kept hearing him preach and he kept bringing up Bible school. And I was just like, man, I kind of want to go to Bible school. I want to know more about the Bible. I thought Bible school was just knowing more about the Bible. I didn't even know it was like you have to become a minister, try to become a pastor or anything like that. So I'm just thinking, I'm going to go. I'm going to learn more about the word and I'll be able to, you know, maybe have a few episodes where I'm preaching the word to somebody, you know, but nah, when I got there. So let me go back a little bit. So, in December of 2022, he was like, we have Bible school that's coming around. The next semester is coming around in January. It's like the mid semester. He was like, you can enroll if you want. He was like telling everybody. And then it hit like late December and I'm like, man, I think I want to do it. So I DM'd Pastor Jonathan on Instagram. I was like, hey, can I still enroll in a Bible school? And he was like, yeah. He was like, tuition's only $1,000 right now. So go, yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right. And I was like, I got $1,000 cash sitting in my closet. I was like, let me take that out and just use it. So I did it.
That's great testimony, brother, because there's not many people that would do that.
Right, right.
You know?
And I did it, right? So I took that $1,000 out and I enrolled in the Bible school, and I get there my first day, and then Pastor, who was Augustine, he was like, okay, well, welcome to class, everybody. He was like, if you want to be a pastor, raise your hand. Like, half the class raised their hand. I'm just, like, looking around. He's like, if you want to be an evangelist, raise your hand. Half the class raised their hand. I'm just looking around.
Yeah.
He's like, if you want to be a prophet, you want to be this, you want to be that, raise your hand. Everyone's raising their hand for something. I'm the only one that didn't raise my hand.
Did he call you out?
He came up to me. He goes, so why are you here? I'm like, I don't know. So I'm trying to figure that out.
I want to learn about Jesus and Scripture. Learn about,
exactly. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. So, and this was during the time where we were fasting for 21 days.
Oh, in January. Yeah.
In January.
Oh, that was so hard.
Yeah, that was
tough.
That
was so hard.
It was tough. But I'm so happy I did it because God opened up so many doors for me from doing that fast. And, so we were fasting during that time, and I was in Bible school, and I kid you not, when I was sitting in class, everyone was, like, paying attention, writing their notes. I'm sitting there on my laptop, like, looking up jobs, like, all right, I don't know if I can do Bible school. Like, I need to find something else to do. So I'm over here, like, looking up all these jobs, right? And then randomly, I get a text from the athletic director at Edinburgh University, where I went to school, and she texted me and says, hey, have you ever thought about becoming a college coach? And I was like, I mean, I would definitely be interested. Like, what's the benefits? And then like 2 weeks into school, she called me, and this is 2 weeks into the fast also. And she calls me and she goes, "Hey, we want to give you the grad assistant, the opportunity to be the grad assistant for Edinburgh University." And I was like, "All right, well, talk to me about it. Like, what is the grad assistant?" Yeah. She was like, "Well, you'll be a position coach. You'll coach the wide receivers." I played defensive back in college. Okay. So like when she said receivers, I was like, I don't know if I want to do that, but yeah. I mean, what's the benefits? And she was like, "All right, you get paid. She's like, you get like $700 every 2 weeks." And I was like, "All right, that's not bad." And I was like, "What else?" She was like, "You get your whole master's degree paid for. So I'll give you a place to stay." And I was just like, "Okay, all right, God, all right."
That's blessing.
Yeah,
that's,
I was like, that's a big blessing. So I was like, "You know what? I think I'm going to do it." So I talked to Pastor Jonathan. I talked to Pastor Augustine. And I talked to the dean, Melissa. And they were all like, "Hey, dude, like, we won't have no hard feelings against you or anything. Like, this is a decision you have to make for yourself. Make sure you pray about it and all this stuff." So I gave it like a week and a half, and I was like, "Okay, I think I just want to," me leaning on my own understanding, I was like, "I think I just want to go coach football. It's what I'm used to." I feel like God opened up the door, even though we didn't even finish the fast yet. I feel like he just opened up the door early for me.
Yeah. So and that's what happens. Like when we press in, when you fast, I mean, all right. The stories in the Bible.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like it does, it all adds up, and that's when things start happening, and right. And God will give you, like I said, I don't know if it's grace or direction, but you know, grace is whenever you get what you don't deserve. Cause I mean, mm-hmm. most of us, God gives us more than we deserve. So that's right. Always grace.
Yes.
But you know, direction is also key. Mm-hmm. So having stuff like that happen,
yeah,
I don't believe that anything is like, you know, by accident. Right. So like I said, you were pressing in, mm-hmm. you were going back and forth. So yeah. You chose that direction to go towards coaching and everything else like that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What I want to say to that, brothers, cause I go back and forth too. And mm-hmm. I love public speaking. Mm-hmm. I love doing this podcast.
Yeah.
I love talking to people and right. changing mindsets. Mm-hmm. And you know, even in earlier episodes of this podcast, I mean, I talk about people like, you know, like David Goggins, if you know who that is, yep. for motivation and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then you got Gary Vaynerchuk, Gary V, mm-hmm. you know, even like Grant Cardone for real estate. Yeah. You got, I mean, from Les Brown, who is one of the best motivational speakers ever. And he's older now, but he's yeah. still out there doing it. Mm-hmm. But he sold out the Georgia Dome, like 80,000 plus people just wow. to hear him speak before you can Google that. Wow. I mean, people aren't touching that.
Yeah.
And they're all people that like touch my heart. So mm-hmm. I feel like the people that really like come at me are the people that hit me like in my feels, mm-hmm. right? So yeah. if I listen to YouTube or motivational stuff or mm-hmm. information, and it's about business and things like that, it's like fact and science and things that you're going to do on like the planet Earth, right?
Right.
The stuff that hits me in my feels, like even like Steve Harvey
yeah.
talking about his ups and downs and stories, hits me.
Yeah.
So that to me, this is where you come into play, mm-hmm. that's still ministry.
Yeah.
You don't have to be in a pulpit.
Yeah.
You don't have to be preaching at a church right. or an evangelist
right.
to still be ministering
right.
positivity,
for sure.
mindset, and the word of God.
Right.
So you being a young man uh-huh. and being able to be in front of, you know, college football players that mm-hmm. are the roughest, toughest, you know, people yeah. on the planet, basically, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you can have insight. And you can tell them and share them some of your trials and tribulations and your testimonies.
For sure.
They're going to make these young men
for sure.
turn into great men. So
for sure.
that is probably, seriously, I mean, my opinion is God was talking to you saying, yeah. listen, you're going in this direction because mm-hmm. you're needed there.
Right.
You're needed for the next generation of what you did.
Right.
And like, I feel it.
Yeah.
Like, I feel it right now when I'm yeah. talking to you about
yeah.
it. You know, like it is. So that's what, you know, God's calling you in that direction right now. Now, one of Jared's mentor, I just had a chance to speak with him a couple of days ago, and we were talking, and it is like, you know, so this is like, you know, you're rung on the ladder, you're going there.
Right.
You don't have to understand what the end game is. You don't
right.
like, you know, when you're 40, you don't have to, you don't have to know what that's coming right now, right?
Right.
But your step right now, mm-hmm. right, your step in that direction is
right.
what you're doing. I think that's awesome and,
yeah.
and amazing. And
yeah.
like I said, the fact that you just, you know, you took your $1,000 and you went to Bible school and you were like, I'm going to go to Bible school just because you didn't even have like a plan, bro. You just,
no
you
plan.
Just wanted to learn more about God and the
literally.
Gospel. And that's all that speaks volumes.
Yeah.
And that, and God can see that. Plus you mm-hmm. were, you know, you were in a fast and everything else like that.
Yeah.
So you got, like I said, that's a break. So you're giving good breaks. You're out there. You're asking. You're doing what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
And I feel like that is catching a good break.
Yeah.
So it is, like I said, like luck is when preparation meets opportunity. Mm-hmm. So you were prepared because you did this your whole life.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
And then opportunity came.
Yep.
But if you weren't prepared and you weren't in the position you were in for sports and everything you've done, you wouldn't have got that opportunity. So
exactly.
There's no such thing as luck. It's like a preparation met opportunity.
Right.
And God reached down. And I'm telling you, like, I feel that. I do.
Yeah.
Like when I was just talking, I just feel that. So I know that you have some scriptures written down and some stuff like that.
Yep.
And you can talk about maybe, like I said, some of these scriptures that you have written down and things, you know, that were placed into your heart from scripture and God and everything to get you to where you're going. Because I can always tell right now, like, you know, here with you, like you know, you got a calling for that for sure. And you're going to go somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, just the fact, everything we just talked about, like shows me that your mind and your heart are in the right place. And that's awesome and amazing, bro.
Yeah.
So like I said, if you want to talk some more, like I said, tell, you know, some of the scriptures and stuff like that, just tell us some of the stuff. Or if you have, like, if you remember anything, like when you were playing football or, you know, in high school, college as a young man, whatever, and like things that like maybe hit you and changed you, or when you pressed in, or even if like, you know, you were reaching on to somebody else, like your fellow teammates or family or anything like that. Like just, hey, the mic's yours, bro. We're here. Like I said, we got time. We got time. So let me know some of the stuff you got written down, bro.
So I'm about to like completely 360 this right now.
Okay. Yeah. That's what we're here for.
So from where I just said, where I took that job opportunity and was coaching football, I'm about to just 360 the whole thing. All right. So in Proverbs 3:5, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding." Right?
Right.
So me taking that job opportunity.
Yeah.
To me, that was me leaning on my own understanding, because I didn't know, like I said, I didn't know about Bible college. I didn't even know what I was doing when I was going into Bible college. Right. So I was like, I'm just going to lean on what I know, football. So I did that. I went there for 4 or 5 months and I loved it. I got to do weight training. That's what I do. I'm a personal trainer. Got to do weight training with all. I was the leader of the weight room, so I led all the strength and conditioning program. We had a head guy that like gave us the workouts, but I like whistled the workouts. Like, oh, let's go. We're on this. We're on this. Next this. Next that. So that's what I did. And then also I coached the receivers. Went through the whole spring ball shenanigans where you just play football in the spring against your own team. So I did all that, and I was watching film, breaking down film for our opponents that we played in the fall, and it was cool. It was a cool thing. It was just, it was a lot of hard work, and then I had a few Bible students, a few guys that I met from Bible college. A few of the students came up, and a guy of the name Matt Antis.
I love Matt.
Great guy,
dude. He's awesome.
Great guy.
Shout out, Matt.
Shout out, Matt. He's awesome. He's like one of my favorite persons in this world.
No, he is.
I love that.
Him and his family and his kids. They just brighten you up every time you see him.
Seriously. And so he hit me up and he was like, "Hey, man, I did an outreach up at Slippery Rock, and I was wondering if we could possibly team up and do one at Edinburgh." And I was like, "Bro, let's do it." So long story short, we end up getting like a whole bunch of the RTBI students and the young adults, people from Revival Today, young adults. And we all teamed up and we did a whole outreach at Edinburgh. We had 185 people in attendance, 33 people gave their life to Christ.
Wow.
And it was just like amazing. Like, I worked harder for that outreach than I did as a coach.
Yeah, yeah.
And so after that went down, I was just like, man, this is something that actually like fulfilled me and brought me joy, brought me the fruits of the spirit, you know? So I was like, why do I love doing that? Like, why did I work harder to run around every dorm and flyer to every single dorm while it was raining? Me and Matt Antis did this. While it was pouring rain and me and him were flying around Edinburgh, the whole university, just flying the college students, trying to get them to come to our event. Yeah. And the fact that we had 185 people and 33 people get a life to Christ, it just like did something to my heart where it was just like fulfilling. And once that all went down, I was like, start having thoughts like, man, do I want to go back to like Bible school? Like, do I want to be a part of this all the time? So summer break hit. I go home. I'm back home. And then all of a sudden, Pastor Jonathan's talking about this no eye has seen, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we get the whole week, there's services all week, twice a week or twice a day.
Yeah, yeah.
And he brought in all these pastors, all these different types of pastors. And Dr. Degg, or Bishop Degg, he came the one day.
Yeah, yeah.
And he literally said, he said, he came for three, he preached for 3 days. And I can't remember if it was the second or third day. But he was like, if you're 25 years old, your window, and I'm 25. It's like, your window for the ministry is like this big. He was like, the time to get into the ministry is now. There's revival coming to the America, to America, and the time to get into ministry is now. And I was just like, oof. It just like, yeah, made me like, whoa.
Isn't it funny how, I mean, Pastor Jonathan's fire. Like, Holy Ghost fire all the time.
Yes.
And like, whenever you're listening, even like, you know, like Dag and anyone else that comes in, it's like sometimes you're like, is he talking directly to me?
Yeah.
And it feels like that sometimes, you
yeah,
know?
Right.
And, yeah. So,
yeah. So, right. Yeah, I just like felt like he was talking directly to me. And when he said that, I was like, man, I definitely have been thinking about going back to Bible school, but like, I would literally have to go up to Edinburgh, tell the coaches I'm not coaching. Like, I was like thinking of everything I would have to do. Like, there's a lot I have to do. A lot of people I have to talk to.
Right.
A lot of people that have to persuade that, like, listen, I'm not going to coach. Like, I'm going to go back to Bible school. And I was like, all right, you know what? I'm just going to keep coming every day. I'm going to keep seeking the kingdom first, as it says in the Bible. Seek the kingdom first. So I kept seeking the kingdom. So I was like, I'm not missing that one day of this no eye has seen. I'm going every day. So I went every day. And every single time I went, something hit me when it was like, so whoever was preaching, it always hit like, wow. And I would write stuff down like, man, like, dang, God, are you trying to tell me to go back to Bible school? Because now I'm thinking about the verse of Proverbs 3:5, like, lean not on your own understanding, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm like, all right, I'm about to just go up to Pastor Jonathan after one of these church services and ask him if it would be okay for me to go back to Bible school.
Right.
So after service, him and Pastor Kofi are sitting by Pastor Jonathan's nice chrome car, or whatever color he got. That's a nice car, though.
The mirrored Escalade. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Shout out Pastor Jonathan.
Shout out
always.
Pastor John. Yeah. Yeah. So I go up to him and I'm like, hey, I'm Maurice, and he's like, I know who you are. You know, Jonathan has that voice and that look. Like, I know who you are. Like, you came up to me and talked to me about this, and before. I'm like, all right, well, it feels good to, like, know my pastor remembers.
His brain, Jonathan's brain is so sharp because he has to meet, I don't even know,
thousands of people.
Yeah, over a thousand week. A week, like, new people. And he remembers stuff.
Yeah, he does. You know? He does.
Yeah.
So when I told him that, I was like, hey, I was just thinking, like, coming back to Bible school, like, would that be okay? And he was like, this is exactly what he said. He said, oh, he said, you're able to come back. You were already in there, right? I was like, yeah. He was like, yeah, you're able to come back. He was like, now you know the devil can't pull you away. And I was like, wow, like, that's real. Like, maybe the devil did try to pull me away. Who knows? But at the end of the day, I think God was just trying to, like, show me that, listen, you can have, I can give you whatever. I can open doors whenever. I can do whatever I want. I can give you this. I can give you that. Like, it's just really on you to choose. And it's on you to understand that you're not going to have, like, don't lean on your own understanding. Like, go with what your heart wants you to do. And talked to Pastor Jonathan. He gave me the okay. And I was like, all right, I got to, like, make moves now. And I got to put everything into action.
Yeah.
So his uncle, Ted, when he came the one night, he said for the tithes and offering, he was like, give what you don't think you can give. And I was like, all right, I'm going to just give my best. Like, I'm not going to, I'm going to give literally my best. I had like $126 in my bank account at the time. And I was like, you know what? I'm tithing it all. I don't care. So I tithed $126, tithed it all. Then the next morning, I went to go work out with my cousin. His name's Jordan Whitehead. He played for Pitt. Now he plays for the Jets.
Oh, right.
So I worked him out, and I worked out his boy, Dane Jackson, that also played for Pitt, and now he plays for the Buffalo Bills. So I went to go train them up at Pitt, and I trained them, gave them a nice workout, and at the end of the workout, I get a text from somebody that's in RTBI, and they're like, someone just came in and gave you $2,000 for your tuition at Bible school. And I was just like, nah,
like
God.
Anonymous? Did you ever find out who?
I found out who it was because she came up to me and was like, "Hey, I heard you're going to Bible school." And I can just tell on her face that, like, were you the one that gave me $2,000? And then she ended up telling me it was her. And to this day, I'm just super thankful for her. And like every time I see her, I just give her a big hug and have a conversation with her. So, So long story short, I got the $2,000, and I was like, "All right, now it's on me now to accept what God's trying to give me." So I went up to Edinburgh. I drove up there, went up to the coaches, talked to the offensive coordinator and the head coach. and they were super cool about it. They were super understanding, and I just stopped coaching, and now I'm going back to Bible school.
Right, right. So. And that brings me back to like what I was telling you, because hey, to like everybody out there, like I don't know Maurice's story. Like Jared just called me and was like, "Hey, Maurice is coming. I know who Maurice is, but I don't know the story." I'm like, you know what? We're gonna keep it raw on the podcast,
yeah.
And we're just gonna go through stuff, and I'm gonna learn as I go. But like I was saying, you know, earlier about rungs on the ladder and steps, like your step at that moment was to go do the football thing, mm-hmm. you know, and you probably did help a bunch of young people. And I'm sure just by talking to you here, like you impacted some people. I guarantee it.
Yeah.
Maybe not everybody, but I'm sure you impacted some people and it's going to resonate with them mm-hmm. through their careers or whatever else they do in life, which Amen. Is great. And then, Amen. Like I said, then you come back, you know, full circle here, like you said,
yeah.
and you're back in a Bible school and you're back doing your thing. And like I said, you are, I mean, you're young, brother. I mean, yeah. we're all young. Like, yeah. you know, I'm still in my 30s. So it's like, you know, time for God is totally different than time for us. So like mm-hmm. his time for us, and that's why anything I go through that, like you're conflicted about that, I'm conflicted about things.
Mm-hmm.
You got to kind of just give it to God. I'm like, all right, I don't want to will it myself.
Right.
But I kind of have to make educated decisions too
sure.
on the earth planet for survival.
For sure.
Right. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, what's right and what's wrong. Or, mm-hmm. and I'm willing to go through seasons of sufferings because like I said, I've been through sufferings in my mm-hmm. life, you know, at my mm-hmm. age, I've been through stuff. So it's like, I'm willing to go through as much suffering as need be or downward spirals to reach what God wants me to do. Mm-hmm. And ultimately that's the goal,
right?
That's the goal, bro.
For
so
sure.
I feel like that's where I'm at as well as you. But I think, like I said, that story is awesome and amazing.
Yeah.
And you know what? You're probably going to get to tell that story to a lot of people. And it's going to, like I said, your story is going to help change people's lives as well.
For sure.
And you're still going to go through the stuff that you need to go through to get where you're going. But
100%.
Like even, like I said, when you feel lost, there's still people that are going to help. Like I said, mm-hmm. you know, you got the phone call
yep.
to go coach. That was going to help you out on where you were. Mm-hmm. That's fine. Then you get back into the Bible school and then somebody, you know, someone reaches out and pays for your tuition and right. stuff like that. Like there's, when you're in a circle and like you're a child of God for real, like, and I'm finding this out like really like the last like 5 years, you know, mm-hmm. like when I've really been pressing in and pressing in, because like 10 years ago, I just started to get like my life really together. Mm-hmm. And then the past, like I said, half a decade, like I've really been pressing in on this stuff mm-hmm. and scripture because I just had enough. And yeah. I was like, you know what? Everything I do is wrong.
Yeah.
And if everything I do is wrong, mm-hmm. like right, that definition of insanity is like doing the same thing over and over again, and expecting yep. different results. I'm like, mm-hmm. I can't do this no more. There's
right.
So I was like, God, and I was just like, all right, you know, you take the wheel, like
yeah.
for real.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still, you're still conflicted. Like, what do I do? What's the right move? Whatever.
Right.
And it's just like, at this point in my life, I have like ultimate faith. And like last week we were talking about
yeah.
the faith of like Daniel 3, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, mm-hmm. or like Hebrews 11:1, you know, mm-hmm. the faith is the substance of what's not seen, you know,
right.
and things like that. And I think that's like where you're at. It's like, great. Whenever I see like young people,
mm-hmm.
especially, you know, at RTC
yeah.
and stuff like that, you see like these teenagers, the mm-hmm. youth and everything. And they're so pressed in
yeah.
to like their faith
yeah.
and living this great life
yeah.
and just like, blocking out the negativity
right.
and the badness of the world and just focusing on like their stuff. I'm like,
mm-hmm.
man, I wish that was me.
Yeah.
But like I grew up, you know, a little bit different. Jared yep. grew up a little bit different. And it's like we're products of our environment, but mm-hmm. we're making better choices as time progresses.
Amen.
You know? But like, yeah, I love hearing this. Like I love hearing all this, man. I think that's a great story. So right now,
mm-hmm.
Your full attention is on Bible school.
Yeah, full attention is on Bible school. Yeah, I'm just like I volunteer for young adults.
Right.
I volunteer for youth. Like how you said, like the youth, when you see them pressing in, like
yeah.
like that's why I volunteer for the youth, because
yeah.
they motivate me to like, man, if they can have faith like this at this young age,
right.
like what am I doing? Like they're this young.
Yeah.
They're having all this faith. I need to have faith as the child does. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, and that's what we just said. Like Christian means like childlike faith.
Yes.
That's what I was talking about like last week.
Yeah.
Is like in the movies, like I said, I'll bring it up again, but like in like Christmas, not Christian movies, Christmas movies,
mm-hmm.
like the little kids can see, hear all the Christmassy stuff and
yeah.
the adults can't.
Right.
Like in the Polar Express, you know, little kids can hear like the one bell ring that the kid
yeah.
got from Santa Claus
yeah.
and the adults couldn't hear it because
right.
they don't have the faith.
Faith, yeah.
But the thing is, you know, Santa Claus mm-hmm. is what it is, you mm-hmm. know, in the world, it is
yeah.
what it is. But Jesus, God, the Holy Ghost, this
yeah.
scripture is facts.
It's 100%
real. 100% facts.
It's stamped.
It is. But things like that, like Christmas, that's a metaphor for how you should trust and put faith in things.
Right.
And it is true. But like I said, man, so that, I think that's awesome.
Yeah.
And like I said, you got some scripture and you got some Bible verses and stuff like that.
Yeah.
We're gonna roll still.
I wanted to talk about how Jared had a huge impact on my life.
Yeah, Jared is, he's the real deal.
He's
like, people don't get it. I'm like, and then sometimes, people that don't know him, just like anybody else, this world, listen, the world is so big and everyone has an opinion.
For sure.
But like when people start coming at Jared sometimes on the internet, which, the internet's stupid because people are behind keyboards. It's not whatever, you know.
Right.
And facts aren't there. When people start coming at him, I'm like, just let it be. And he knows that. Like I said, sorry, Jared, you're not here. I'm not like, but I'm saying when I see people come at him, I'm like, you don't even know this dude. I'm like, this dude is like 100% legit. Super like legit. His whole life, his 7 days a week, 168 hours in a week, his whole life is just helping others. He don't care. He like, he wouldn't care, dude, if he has no car, no house, no nothing, no food. He'd fast and walk everywhere just to help people.
Yeah.
Like, and that's his whole life.
Yeah.
And like, that's what he's a mentor to me too, brother. Like, he really is. Like, being around him,
it's awesome.
Like, he lives life right. He doesn't swear. He doesn't, which is stupid little things that anybody can do, but I'm saying, but his life and his heart are 100% in the right place. So whenever I see him, I'm like, how can I be more like him?
Yeah.
Because he's closer to being like Jesus than I am. Mm-hmm. So it's like, when I see that, and it's just his whole demeanor, and it's real. It's not fake. He's not putting on the show. It's 24/7. It's when he's by himself, when he's with his kids, when he's with me, whatever. So it's surreal. Like I said, we'll press into that. We'll try to, we'll try to go like 5, 6 or whatever more minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, guys. So we're in the studio, and they got time blocks. So we got time blocks here. But hey, we'll go. Like, so no rush, but we're just here until we got to roll.
Yeah,
we're on God's time.
Amen.
You know what I mean?
Amen. God's time. So, God's time's the best time.
All right. So let's talk about Jared a little bit with you.
Yeah. I just wanted to give a quick recap of I learned as a Christian, when you become when you really pour in, you just become a walking testimony.
Yeah.
Like,
I feel like that. Yeah. I feel like that too.
Like, bro, we're walking testimonies. Like, my first time I met Jared, I worked at a physical therapy place right next to his gym when he was in Hopewell.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And
at this little shopping center, strip mall. Yeah.
Yep. Yep. And I'm like, I see Bible verses on his little stand outside. I'm like, who is this dude? Like,
and let's, you see him.
Yeah. And I see him. Like, I'm like, who's this dude with all these tattoos all up to his neck and his fingertips? Like, talking about Jesus, like, what's he know that I don't know?
Yeah.
So, and I was going through, Lord knows that I was going through a rough time. Like, I had a girlfriend situation. I was like smoking weed all the time. Like, my mind was just all over the place. I didn't know who I was. I didn't know what I wanted to do.
That's most young people.
Yeah.
We're still trying to find out.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So I was going through a tough time, and I walked out of the work one day, and Jared ran out of the building, was like, hey, man, what's up, man? He's like, introduced himself
to
me.
That's what he does?
Yeah. He just popped out on me. I'm like, what does this dude want? So he's just like, introduced himself, and I'm like, all right, yeah, I'll stop over. So he showed me his app that he has where you can schedule workouts. And he had all these workouts listed, like 7 a.m., 6 a.m.
Yeah.
And all these workouts throughout the day with groups. And I was like, I'm not working out with no group, but I'll do this $5 come in for open gym where you can just work out by yourself. I'll do that one. So I scheduled for that one. And I scheduled at a time where I knew no one was going to be there. So I get in there, I'm working out, and my first thing I did when I woke up was I smoked, took a shower, and I went, because I like to smoke and work out.
A lot of people do.
Yeah, so that's what I love to do. So I went to the gym, and I'm sitting there punching the bag, lifting, and I'm punching the bag, and I'm like hammering the bag, because I went in there with the mindset I'm fighting my demons. Like, that's what I used to say all the time. So I'm like fighting my demons, like punching the bag super hard, like imagine myself just beating the crap out of myself because I'm trying to get the demons out. Like, that's what I used to do when I used to go to Jared's gym. And then one day I didn't think no one was in there, but he was in there like in the back, and he just came out of nowhere and was like, he was about to leave. He was like, hey man, can I pray for you? And I was like, sure. And he started praying for me, and he just started naming everything that I was going through. Like the people that were like judging me and stuff, like the things that I was like obsessed with doing that I shouldn't have been doing. And he just started like name dropping everything. And I just start crying, like bawling my eyes out. And then he gave me a hug. He left. And then I went back to punching the thing, the bag. I couldn't even punch it anymore. Like, I just felt like I had nothing to fight. Like, I just felt like everything was let off. Like, there was nothing else to fight.
That's Holy Ghost, bro. The
Holy Ghost had an encounter with me. Like, just hit me supernaturally. And then he invited me to Revival Today. I went to Revival Today, and the first person I seen preach at Revival Today was Ted Shuttlesworth. And he's walking up to people saying, he's doing the same thing that Jared did to me, telling them everything they're going through and like praying for them and like setting them free from their sickness or their disease or whatever they had going on with themselves. And I'm like, what the heck is like, how do these dudes have these superpowers? Like, are they like superheroes? Like, what's going on? But then the more I went to the church, I just found out it was the word, because I seen Jonathan. And then it's funny because when I think of the Shuttlesworth, I think of like Jonathan, Ted, and Ted Jr. I think like Jonathan, to me, he's like the freaking Tom Brady of the churches.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I think of Ted, he's like the Bill Belichick of churches. And then I think of Ted Jr., he's like the Gronkowski of churches, you know? So like when I see them and I hear them preach, it's just like, man, they have power because they buy into the word. They do what the Bible says. And ever since then, like, I'm super grateful and thankful for Jared, because now I'm like more on fire than I've ever been. I learned so much about the Bible. It's not just me like reading a scripture, posting it, and going on with my everyday life. It's like, no, I read the Bible and I act on what the Bible says and I live it.
And that's the difference.
That's the difference.
It's not just with faith and religion. It's like, you know, you got all these people, they post motivational stuff. They say motivational things. But, like, if you don't feel it and you're not acting on it,
right,
you're just saying stuff. And it's empty, which is fine. Just like, you know, people are like, hey, you know, don't tell me, show me. Like, don't tell me, show me.
Yep.
So you can tell somebody, I won't do this again, or I'm sorry for this. Well, show me.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with all this stuff. So once you start, like, living it and everything else like that, it starts changing your life.
For sure.
But as far as, like, people like, you know, Jared up to Jonathan and the Shuttlesworth and, you know, his family and everything else like that. Like, yeah, it says in the Bible, like it says, when you're a child of God and you're connected to God, you will have godly power.
Yeah.
So you're connected. And when you're living your life right and you're righteous and you actually have the faith and you believe in it, it's inside your body and soul, when you've been touched by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
You will be able to, you know things. You will be able to heal people. Mm-hmm. You will be able to pray for people and put your hands on people. It says it right there. I mean, he gave the power to the disciples to heal too.
Yeah.
Jesus wasn't the only one that did miracles. He gave the power to the disciples to go out to different towns and everything else like that. And he gave them that power, and it's in the scripture.
In the scripture.
So like that is, and like I said, everyone's on different paths of their journey, right?
Yep.
So like new people, it might be weird seeing that.
Yeah.
It might be weird to try to understand that, but the Bible says a mustard seed of faith, right? So as long as you're stepping in the right direction, then you're doing the right thing and you're pressing in. So that's your start of the journey. As you climb up, you're going to start seeing all this stuff. You're going to understand it more. Mm-hmm. You're going to get into the scripture. You're going to see more things.
Right.
And then you're going to understand it. Mm-hmm. And then you're going to have somebody come to you, like people come to me, you know, and they'll be like, well, what this, what about this? Or how about that? Or like, you, I can't just tell you, I can't even talk to you for an hour, 2 hours, or have you along with me for a day. I can't make you feel this. I can't make you absorb it. Mm-hmm. I can tell you all I want, but they're just words.
Yeah.
You have to press in. You have to start this journey first, press in, give it to God. And then after like 6 months, tell me how you feel. After a year, tell me how you feel. Mm-hmm. After the next 2 years. And I guarantee if you keep pressing and going, you're going to be like, wow. And then once again, that person will be here and someone else is going to come along and ask them all these questions. And they're like, listen, you need to go through the process. Yep. And then I wanted to say too, I want to put this out there real fast. That, let's see, where am I? Oh, over here. All right. So look, whenever I seen a preacher was preaching, and a young gentleman came up to him and said, hey, listen, can I be a Christian and smoke pot? And the preacher said, you sure can. He's like, I don't think you understand me. Can I be a Christian and still smoke marijuana? And the preacher's like, yes. He's like, no, listen, hold on. And he reaches in and he pulls out, you know, a blunt. He's like, this right here, I can smoke this and still be a Christian. And the preacher said to him, he said, do you clean yourself up before you get into the shower? And he said, no, I get in the shower to get clean, you know, to go out and do whatever. He's like, right. He's like, so why do you think you have to clean yourself up to come to Jesus? Because you come to Jesus And then you start getting cleaned up.
Wow. Yes.
And that's how it is. So that's the whole Christian's mission of Jared and I, since we had some screwed up lives and everything, but we've always been good hearted people.
Yeah.
We didn't always necessarily do the right thing.
Yeah.
And that's what this is. Mm. This is, you know, find that mustard seed of faith. Mm-hmm. Press in. You know, if you have questions, start asking them. Get into a Bible study group. Go to a church. Have conversations just like me and you can sit at a Starbucks and have these conversations.
Yeah, right.
And that would be amazing and awesome, and we can just feed off each other.
Right.
But you have to start somewhere. Mm. Same with the gym and stuff. Like with the gym, you don't just go there and in a month you got a six pack and you're jacked.
Right.
I mean, you have to, you're like, oh, running, this sucks.
Right.
Hold on, I have to stop drinking pop. Oh, this is awful. I like pop.
Yep.
I got to stop, you know, eating McDonald's.
Yep.
And then slowly but surely, you're like, you look at yourself in the mirror and you're like, whoa, whoa, where the, oh, yeah, what's up? You know what I mean?
Right.
And then you start putting up some weight.
Yeah.
And then you run, like, you can run a mile. And you're like, I can run a mile. And you're like, on the, you know, you're like, yeah, this. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, you start seeing the results.
Yep.
You know, you start building into it. So then you press in harder.
Right.
And then after a while, you look at yourself and you're like, I'm a whole different human being than I was like a year ago.
Yeah.
And you're blown away. And then, like, you know, then you start, you know, you're like, you're feeling yourself and you're feeling
yourself.
Good. And it's the same. I use that because that's, you know, sports in the gym and fighting and everything has been in my life, you know, my whole life. So that's a good analogy for, like, for me as well. And it is with you.
Yep.
But it's real easy, like I said. So just like with faith.
Mm-hmm.
And pressing into the Bible and learning about God and going down this route,
yeah.
It's the same as, like, and I'm sure you probably had this with friends and kids in college or whatever. Mm-hmm. When someone comes up to you and it's like March, right? And everybody's like, summer's coming, pool time, whatever.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, how do I lose like 20 pounds? Like, how do I lose? And you're like, well, what's your diet like? And they're like, okay, well, honestly, you know, I'm like, do you drink pop a lot? Do you drink beers? Do you eat fast food? Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, all right, well, first off, diet. And you know, diet is key. Diet is
super important.
Super important. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you're going to have to stop drinking pop. You're going to have to stop eating Chick-fil-A every day. You can't go to Uncle Sam's and get steak hoagies or Pepe's.
Right.
You can't. And they're like, that's my only happiness. Like, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah.
Well, then I can't do nothing with
you. Help
you. Then you're lost.
Yeah.
You're lost and you need to own it and take control, you know, and go down that route. So that's how I feel about all that. But the metaphor, I just seen that not too long ago where that preacher was talking to the young kid. And I was like, we all kind of know this stuff. But I'm like, that's a really good metaphor or analogy or whatever.
That
and it's
real good.
It is true. Like, you come to Jesus to get cleaned up. Because I know so many people like, oh, I've been wanting to go to church, but I just can't. I gotta wait till I fix some things.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Dude,
Jesus died for you.
Right.
And he rose again. He took that burden so that you can have the life and you can actually get into heaven.
Yeah.
Because we were all condemned to hell.
Right.
But it's the life choices, you know, and we all have sin and stuff like that. It's the life choices that we can change.
Mm-hmm.
We can grasp hold of Jesus, you know, and we can go into the scripture. We could change our lives and be the best people that we can be.
Yeah.
Now, like I said, is the path going to be perfect? No, but the Bible does say glory to glory to glory. So if you have a setback, make sure you're surrounded by the good people in your life, right?
Yes.
Your circle's good
to
pull you out of that pit again and not judge you rather than people that will pull you down in the pit.
Right.
And you always hear that too, especially with addicts and stuff like that. The number one, like, relapse is not because they were depressed. It's because they were around someone else that had the stuff to get them high. And we're like, yo, just, you know, you've been good for a month or two or 6 months. Let's just have a good time for, you know, for old time's sake. Let's just, and then you screw up.
Yeah.
But you need to be around the people that are like, all right, listen, that's okay. Let's pull you back out of the pit.
Yep.
Let's help you. Let's get you back on the right track. Yeah. So, you know, there's all that too, bro.
Yeah, that was good because it's like who you're surrounded with is who you're going to be. And it's just like the disciples, man. They surround themselves with Jesus. So that's why they're in this book. That's why they're able to.
And all the disciples, they were not perfect.
They weren't perfect at all, right?
They were all,
A lot of people in the Bible weren't perfect. A lot of people were.
Yeah. But it's because Jesus came for the sick and the poor.
Yeah.
You know, not the wealthy and the healthy. Like, he came to pull people out of the pit.
Yeah.
And that's what he did. And he sat with sinners. Doesn't mean he sinned.
Right.
You know, and I say this too. It's like, you might see me somewhere with a beer in my hand.
Mm-hmm.
I like beer, you know, but you don't see me drunk.
Right.
I spent my whole 20s. I shut down every bar every night of the week, just getting blasted. I did that. That was my life.
Yeah.
And anybody, say someone that knows, sees, you know, that sees me doing all this stuff 10 years later after I basically quit all that stuff. And they're like, they remember that. I'm like, that's not, you don't even know me.
Right.
Even if you knew me 2 years ago, you probably don't know, because I just keep evolving and growing, trying to be the best me. But you might see me somewhere out with some friends, you know, and you might see a beer in my hand.
Mm-hmm.
I go out, I get pizza, I get, you know, I get dinners, I do whatever, and I'll get a beer or like two.
Right, right.
That's nothing.
Yeah.
I don't even catch up. I just like, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I know a lot of people like getting on alcoholic stuff and things like that. Yeah. But I'm just saying, so like, you might see that, but that's not who I am.
Right.
And you can't judge me just, oh, I seen Glenn somewhere with a beer in his hand. Mm-hmm. I wasn't getting drunk.
Right.
I just, you know, just like people like a glass of wine with their dinner or something like that.
Right.
Sometimes, and this isn't, it's not even all the time. Yeah. I don't even have beer in my house.
Right.
You know, and it's just like, but I still like to do that, but I'm not perfect,
right,
you know?
Right.
So like I said, that's, we're not perfect, but we're going through, you know, all the steps and the processes.
Sure.
And
for
like
sure.
I said, that's where we're at.
It's levels. It's levels. Yeah. It's levels.
Yeah.
To piggyback on.
Yeah. We'll keep it going for a little bit.
It's
like
so crazy. Matt Antis just called me.
Oh, man, you should have picked that, put on my speaker.
Should I? Shall I call him back? Put him on the speakerphone?
Yeah, call him on the speakerphone real fast.
Love this.
Put him right up near the microphone.
Hopefully he answers.
Hey, what's up, man?
What's going on, Matt?
Not too much.
Man, hey, Matt.
You're still able to...
Matt.
Who is that?
Hey, it's Glennie. You're live on the Christian's podcast right now.
Wait, who is this?
It's Glennie.
Oh, Glenn.
Hey, you're right next to the microphone on speakerphone, bro.
No way.
We're on the Christian's podcast.
Banker, if you want to buy or sell, let me know.
What, real estate?
There you go, real estate. Light them up, Matt. Light them up.
Sorry, I had to put a plug.
Yeah, as you should.
Matt Antis, everybody. This is who he was talking about on your mission.
Yeah, this
you guys
is
went up to Edinburgh?
Yeah, went up to Edinburgh.
Edinburgh.
Yep.
Yeah, we gave you a shout out for that, Matt.
Yeah, and Matt's going to do some more big things. He's doing a whole campus ministry thing with the young adults group, and we're about to light up all the campus ministries or all the campuses with our ministry. Yes, so just be ready for that.
Yeah. Yes,
am I seriously live?
Like, yeah, you're live. You're live. You're right now. You're right
I should have FaceTimed you.
You're on speakerphone right next to the microphone, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you're on a college campus, reach out because we would love to come to a campus near you.
That's right.
Awesome.
And preach the gospel.
Amen. Amen. And free giveaways.
Free giveaways.
Right.
It's a great event. Don't want to miss.
Don't want to miss it. Don't want to miss it.
Yep.
Hey, we're gonna wrap this up though, Matt. So Maurice will call you back.
Yeah, I'll call you back in like 5 minutes.
All right. Much love, brother. Much love.
Take care,
man. All
right,
bye-bye.
Love that guy.
Yeah, he's solid. He's solid,
solid
man.
Solid dude.
How about that? See, we were just talking about he's calling while we got him on the show.
Right, right. Crazy. You start talking about him, and then he just comes up.
Yeah. Oh, man, but yeah.
Yeah, man. And one last thing to talk about, another verse, is just that I just start learning that, like how you said, the more you grow, and the more you like keep pressing in,
right,
the more that God's able to show you, and the more that you'll grow in those spiritual levels. And like soul winning, I never really knew anything about soul winning, but it says in the Bible that it says in Psalm 71:15-16, it says, I will tell everyone about your righteousness all day long. I will proclaim your saving power. Though I am not skilled with words, I will praise your mighty deed, O servant Lord. I will tell everyone that you alone are just. And it's just like, when you do that, like some people don't even get to hear the word of God, don't even know who Jesus is. But when you do that, it just plants a seed. Like the same way you said, I planted a seed in those kids at Edinburgh. You're right, because the quarterback from Edinburgh on the Edinburgh football team, he called me last night. We talked on the phone for an hour. He's coming to church on Sunday. He's bringing him and a few other of his teammates down because of the seed I planted, because I told them about Jesus. Because Matt came down and talked about Jesus. Young adults came down and talked about Jesus. The seed was planted. So when you do the works of the word, do what the word says, it's like the seeds just... They harvest, man. They harvest.
And like, you know, just like you said with seeds, man, like they take a while sometimes to grow, and they need rain, right? They need some bad. It's everything. It's all the stuff together. And then like when you're pressing in, you're going in the right direction too. Like people are always like, how come bad stuff happens, or how come I'm doing everything right and this happened or that happens? Like, why do you think? Because there is. Is even if you're not religious or have faith, you understand that there's good and evil, 100%, because there's some very evil people.
100%.
So it's like whenever you're good and you're trying to do the right thing, and you're trying to press in, you're going to have some obstacles.
Yeah.
Like God's there for you. Like like the Moses story. Mm-hmm. Like God said, hey, listen, free my people, go to Pharaoh, do all this stuff, right? And I'm going to be with you every step of the way. Mm-hmm. And it was hard for him.
Yeah.
And it was just, it was funny because I was just reading this on the Bible app in the morning, like reading these verses again and going through stuff. But it's like, so God said he'd be with him. Mm-hmm. And that journey wasn't easy by any mm-hmm. means. And it was probably super scary and everything else like that. And even like he parted the Red Sea and he got through there. And then all the water came back down and it killed, you know, all the bad people. So they couldn't chase him. Even after that, they were wandering around and all his people were like, like complaining, like we've been wandering for so long and I'm tired. And, you know, so picture like, you know, the whole from start to finish, you know, with all that, like how he felt, like he had to ask God, like, how come you told me to do this? How come this bad stuff's happening? Or how come it's not easier? How, it's just how life is, bro. It's like I said, nothing good comes easy. Like, you know, man, and it's a sports thing too, because like I'm a huge fan of Michael Jordan. Yeah. I'm a huge fan of Kobe Bryant. Mm-hmm. And like and I say this all the time, and people probably hear, are tired of hearing me talk about it, but it's like when you press into like Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, Tim Grover, who was their trainer, and Tim Grover has the Relentless book, and he has a second one out that just came out recently. Tim Grover's a beast. Michael Jordan and Kobe were a beast. Yeah. Here's the thing. Whenever I was younger, even like your age kind of, I still would think, and you know because you've been in sports your whole life. Mm. And like I said, I did a lot of stuff too, but I would think like, oh, real easy for them. They were just born that way.
Yeah.
No, they weren't.
Not at all.
No, they weren't. Yeah. They, like I said, all them stories when you hear like, you know, Kobe was in the gym at 4 a.m. and all them guys were getting a limo hammer drunk from drugs and prostitutes or whatever else it was. Mm-hmm. And they were rolling at 4 a.m. and Kobe's in the gym shooting, already drenched in sweat at 4 a.m.
Yep.
That's why he was who he was.
Yeah.
Same with Michael Jordan. He was relentless and he did extra. He did more than anybody, which is why he was who he was.
Yep.
Because like I said, in high school, he didn't even make his varsity team.
Yeah.
Dude didn't make his varsity team in high school. So the best, the GOAT, in my opinion,
yeah. Most other people, I agree.
Didn't even make varsity.
Yeah.
He didn't make varsity.
It's crazy.
So what, you know what he did? That fired something up in him. He's like, you know what?
Yeah.
I got to work twice, three times as hard.
Yep.
You know, and so that's what I'm saying. So like people just look at that. I'm like, you know, like realistically they were doing what they love, but like how hard was their life or how bad did that suck?
Yeah.
You know, like how bad did that suck? Like even like I just seen a thing from Michael Phelps, all the gold medals for swimming and stuff like that. He said for like years straight, he's like, I didn't miss one day.
Wow.
No matter what, one day I was in the pool every day.
Wow.
So other people that just work 40-hour jobs or do this and that, and they're out partying and doing whatever, these guys were 365, 24/7, dedicated to their craft, which is why they got where they were. It wasn't no magic. You weren't just born like that. You weren't.
Right.
They went through obstacles and it was tough and it was hard and they just kept pressing in. They didn't give up. That's why they're the greatest. That's why people know their names. That's why they were as successful as they were.
Yep.
And that's fact, bro. Yeah, that's fact. So like that's fire to put out there. You have to know.
Yeah.
So if you have something in your heart, it's not going to be easy. You're going to have to go through the trials and tribulations.
For
but
sure.
It is like say glory to glory to glory.
Yep.
But if you're rolling with God and you're connected to God, that takes anxiety away.
Yeah.
It takes depression away because for real, if you know where you're going, right? You know this is where you're going. You're going from here to there.
Yep.
Whatever happens in between doesn't even matter.
Right.
And it's hard, like I said, young people, because you don't have a lot of life experience yet, like teenagers, stuff like that, high school age, you don't know a lot yet.
Right.
So you let emotions kind of control you. Plus, we're brainwashed with social media and the news and media and stuff like that to like let things affect you. But if you press into God, you know, like even Dakota, like I said, she's 15 now. She shares a lot of like her notes and stuff on the Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, dude, I just look and I'm like, she's so smart and she's so happy and she's not going to be defeated by the ways of the world.
Yep.
And she's a different breed of human. And I'm like, this is crazy that this young 15-year-old girl is so awesome and smart. And she's pressing into scripture and not letting this stuff affect her.
Yeah.
And and it's harder for like people, like I said, that are stuck in their ways. Like when you're like 30, 40 plus and stuff, and you've had all the stuff of life and you beat in you already.
Yep.
To like just grab a hold of all this stuff and start beating like anxiety and beating depression and fighting the negativity and just having all this faith if you were born and led your whole life to believe something else,
right?
Which is difficult, but the whole thing is you don't quit, you don't give up. And it is, like I said, the circle and the company you keep, man.
Yeah.
You know, that's going to get you on that path.
That's important. company you keep is important.
No, I preach that all day, every day.
Yeah.
And I'll preach it till the day I die. And I've been preaching it, you know, forever once I started realizing that, you know what I mean? You got to surround yourself with good people that will bring you up and help you out.
Yep.
And like I said, as far as me and my life, it's like, I want to be around Christian people
100%
because they're just on a different level. 100%. You can be a really good person, right? You can be a great person, help people, do everything,
right?
Be in the gym, have a lot of money.
Yeah.
That's still different than being like a real Christian.
Yep.
When you have the Holy Ghost and you have Jesus and you've been touched by Jesus, we just operate on a different level.
Yeah.
So these conversations, I can have these with other people and they just think like I'm crazy or they don't understand. I can have it with you, Matt Antis, Jared, Jonathan, you name it, and they know what's up and it resonates better. It just makes me feel at peace.
Yep.
You know?
Literally.
Yeah.
It's fruits of the Spirit are real, man.
Right on. So I guess, we'll wrap this up. I said, a long one, guys. Yeah. We're at 50 minutes. Bang, bang.
We could have probably went for another hour, honestly.
Yeah, I know. Remember I was telling you?
Yeah.
I told you, like, the first time Jared and I got in the studio, we talked for like an hour back and forth, and it felt like nothing. Yeah. I'll talk forever.
Yeah.
But it's all good stuff, but it's like we're just having an organic conversation about life, Jesus, and stuff that we've went through.
Yep.
And that's what makes it work. That's why it's great, because it's real. It's organic, like I said.
It's real, for sure.
You know, and I'm happy that you came here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
You know what I mean? I am happy you came here, and I'm happy that I got to hear your story, and I'm happy that everything you're involved with, and I said, we're always going to stay in contact and Jared and everything with the church. And 100%. Like, we're going to make sure that we just keep pressing in and we just help each other. And that's what we're supposed to do.
For sure.
You know, but like, the saving souls thing, winning souls over, that's what it is.
Yep.
And that's what the Christian mission is too. It's like, it's getting people to Christ. It's getting people to the gospel and the scripture and Jesus to change their lives for the better.
That's right.
There's nothing better than winning people over. Yeah.
That's the best. It's the best thing. That's the best thing you can do as a Christian. It's the most important thing.
It is
that you can do as a Christian, because you're just bringing people to the kingdom.
Right, and it's naturally just helping people.
Exactly.
So yeah. Hey. www.christyinz.io. So Christ+Yinz, Yinzers for Pittsburgh. If you're not from Pittsburgh, Google it, figure it out. We're all Yinzers here. If you're from Pittsburgh, you need to get on board. You need to learn some stuff. We're putting Bible verses, we're putting scripture into some of these podcasts so that you can hear stories from us and you can learn a little bit. So if you don't know and you want to know, learn. We're here. But Glennie B, you know, Maurice, we're out of here. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you for liking, commenting, sharing. Thank you for following. Thank you for everything that you do. In Jesus' mighty name, which is the name of all names. We love you, Pittsburgh. Thank you so much, and rest of the world and country and everywhere else. But thank you so much. We're out. Peace.
Peace.